some of you may already know this. My background is my first degree is not in education. I did not start in the field of education. I actually began my degree, my first degree was in theater. So that's why I'm standing, because I'm so ADD that I've got to keep moving around. And so a lot of what Danny was talking about, that's what I was trained under when I was trained as an actor. We did all of that stuff. And let me tell you, I've used his ideas in my classrooms as well as my workshop, and they work. Kids love to be creative. They're just naturally creative. So most of my work is now in the field of differentiation, advanced level learners, gifted and talented kids. Self-regulation is a big field of mine now as well. And also in brain compatible learning. So I've got a pretty broad area of understanding and work, of expertise. I have taught in the middle school level and as an elementary first grade teacher. I also worked as a district level administrator, a director of gifted programs for the Bloomington, Minnesota public schools for 15 years. So I've been in the field of education for over 30 years now. And one of my super talents or superpowers, as Mark says, one of my superpowers is that I love uncovering every child's talent. I believe every child has a talent worth developing. And that is what I work for every single day. What I'm going to do is I'm going to share with you a design here that your teachers can use, or teachers can use in their classroom, to extend, enrich, and enhance learning, not only in the virtual platform, but also in the general classroom once we get back into the swing of things. Before I can go there, I really have to help you understand what is curriculum. Oftentimes we're told curriculum is the textbook or the book that we're going into a new curriculum. We've got a new math text. Well, that's not your curriculum. That is a source, not the source. And in most cases, 2/3 of the cases with your students, that text is either too low for them or too high for them. So really, your curriculum is what you can clearly articulate is what you want your kids to know, be able to do, and understand. And let me give you a visual to that. So what you want your kids to know is called factual knowledge. Factual knowledge is exactly that. It's vocabulary, it's terminology, it's anything you can look up on your phone and get the answer to, okay? Then there is what is called procedural knowledge. And procedural knowledge is our skills and strategies. Those are the things that we want kids to be able to do. Now, the third level to your curriculum, which is the part of the curriculum that most teachers do not have a very good handle on, is what is called conceptual knowledge. And conceptual knowledge is concepts, generalizations, principles, and theory. This is what we want our kids to understand. Now, most teachers don't know what a concept is, and most teachers don't know what a generalization is, which then leads you to most teachers don't know what a principle is. Now, theory, we oftentimes know what theory are. Theories in the K-12 setting are taught at a factual level. This is the theory of evolution. This is the theory of the Big Bang theory and so forth. So we use that all as factual information, which is fine because it helps us then predict in the concept, okay? Concepts are those big ideas, okay? Now, when we're working within the extension, the enrichment, the enhancement level, we're not working at the factual level because that's just rote. We're not necessarily working at the procedural level because that's just practice. But realize that we have to have that rote. We have to have that practice to then be able to work within the conceptual domain. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to take you through a design that I've created that helps you to enrich, extend, and enhance the learning for all kids, using this model of factual, procedural, and conceptual knowledge. Also, if you know about differentiation, you know that you differentiate differently at the factual level, differentiate differently at the procedural level, and differentiate differently at the conceptual level. So that I can go into at a later time. But let's take this idea of what I've titled as the E3 model: enrichment, extension, and enhancement. So I showed you what curriculum is, okay? So that's really important that you understand what curriculum is, that because it's not tagged to that textbook. And it is supported by your standards. It is then assessed by your assessments, but your curriculum is a living document that is about what do you want kids to know? What do you want them to be able to do? What do you want them to understand by the time you leave? Now, some kids come into the learning already having proficiencies in most of those areas of the curriculum. So what do you do with them? Well, you don't just sit them off in the corner and make them do more of it, because that is like the cardinal sin in the world of gifted education, is to have kids do more of what they're good at, because that just means that when you're gifted, you just do more of it. Well, who wants to be gifted then if you just have to do more of it? So really what we should be doing is deepening the learning for these kids. The other thing is that I know that many of our kids that are the ones who struggle, and let me tell you, they're not struggling. We're struggling. We're struggling because we haven't figured out how to connect with that kid. So let me tell you that there are times that I will use this model with my kids who are quote unquote struggling. You know why they're struggling? They're struggling because they haven't made a connection to what's going on in the classroom. They haven't made a connection to the content. They find no relevance to it. They find no value to what they're learning. But if you use this E3 model, even with your kids who are struggling, they will get it, because it is a way for them to deepen their learning and find value and a worth in what we're teaching. So first I want to share with you the three levels now that are going on in the classroom. So we had three levels. I love the number three because it's easy to remember three things, okay? What do you want kids to know, be able to do, and understand? Very simple. Understand that. In the classroom, we also have three levels going on there too. And we need to understand this, because this is how you can deepen learning for all kids. So the first level, the highest level, the biggest level to the curriculum, is what is called the subject. So the subject is the biggest piece to what we're doing in the classroom. Then we move down into a discipline, and then the discipline moves down into a unit of study. So let me give you an example of what that looks like. So our subject is math. So I'm in my math class. I'm teaching math, okay? But math has subsets to it. And those are called disciplines. So each of the different disciplines within math are really what we want kids to be learning through. So this discipline is going to be algebra. Because, and when you think about this, arithmetic is what kids are learning up to about fifth grade. So it takes 5 years. Well, that arithmetic is the fundamental foundations then for going on into algebra, geometry, trigonometry and calculus and so forth. Each one of those disciplines has relatable strategies and skills, but also has different strategies and skills. So this is why it's important to know what discipline you're working within. The unit of study in this particular case is a unit on statistics. So see that the levels here, that statistics is our unit, the discipline is algebra, the subject is math. Now I'm gonna take that idea of these three levels, and I'm going to turn it sideways. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to show you a way to deepen the learning for all your kids. You can do this virtually, or you can do it within your classroom. If you have a GT pullout program, this could be part of the pullout program. I'm much more inclined to be the push in. So this could be a push in. This also could be something that you work with kids individually. It could be all kids are required to do it, or some kids. I'll go on and kind of explain a few of the different ways that you can use this. So here's my concept that I'm working on. The concept is systems. And I am going to be in the subject of science. Okay? So the subject is science. The discipline is astronomy. The unit is the solar system. So the big idea, the concept, what I want kids to understand by the time they leave me is about this concept called systems. Now, there's a lot of factual knowledge. I want them to know the different names of the planets, and I want them to know what revolution is and access and all that stuff. I also want them to be able to investigate, to observe, to research, and so forth. Those are all the skills that I'm going to be developing. But I really want them to understand this concept of systems, because systems not only are a part of science, they're also a part of music. They're a part of career and technical education. They're a part of family and consumer science. They're a part of physical education. They're a part of everything. So systems is what's called a universal concept. So remember, I'm in a unit of the solar system. Okay, and I'm going to make this around second, third grade-ish, okay? So here's our unit. Our unit is on the solar system. And for the enrichment, it's a focus within the unit. So here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to have kids investigate how comets are impacted by the system. Okay, now comets is not something I'm necessarily going to be teaching to my whole class, but it's a way for kids to extend their learning or enrich what they're doing. So we oftentimes hear of enrichment. Well, here I'm defining it for you. It's a very focused way of getting at deeper information that may not be covered by the general curriculum or the general lessons. Okay, so I'm going to have kids investigating how asteroids or comets are affected or impacting of a system, okay? Now, I'm going to go then to the next part, which is the extension. And the extension now is we're going into the field, which is called the discipline. We're going to go into the field or the discipline of astronomy, okay? So here, in this case, an extension is where I'm going to have kids investigating controversial astronomers. And controversial astronomers and what impact did they have on different systems, such as Galileo Galilei. What impact did he have on the religious systems? What impact did he have on the economic systems? What impact did he have on the scientific systems? So how was he controversial? Okay. So now when I want to move it out into extension or enhancement, the enhancement now takes the subject, and remember now we're in science, the subject is science, and connects it out into other content areas. So in this case, I might have kids working on how the systems of constellations became the framework or the structure for mythology, okay? So I'm connecting ELA to science, all right? So let me give you, now that's an elementary example. Let me give you a secondary example. So the unit of study that we're working on is The Great Gatsby, all right? That's the unit, the book that we're going to be reading, but that's a unit. The concept that I want kids to be working through is the concept or theme, because in literature, theme and concept are relatively the same. The theme is social change, or the concept is social change, all right? So the unit, remember, is The Great Gatsby. The unit is Great Gatsby. So our enrichment, very focused in the unit, is going to be how did Daisy represent women's role of social change of the period? Okay, so very narrow. I'm not going to be talking about that as the general lessons within the unit, but this is a very focused enrichment activity. So that's in the unit. Now we're going to move up into the discipline, and the discipline is going to be literature is our discipline. And in that discipline, we're going to be looking at how authors such as F. Scott Fitzgerald use literature to transmit the information or transmit information about social change. So we'll do some comparing and contrasting between F. Scott Fitzgerald and other authors of the period. The final level, the highest level, now we're in ELA, that's the subject that we're in. We're going to connect this to another content area. And in this case, what we're going to do is we're going to connect it to the content area of mental health. So what we're going to be doing is we're going to be looking at how do the changes that were happening within The Great Gatsby, or how authors were representing that, how do social changes in general impact mental health abuses, or how we deal with our mental schema, Okay, so that's an example of how you move this through. For this purpose, what I want you to understand that when you're developing these E3s, you need to keep these three things in mind. Remember, I love the number three. What is the focus? So again, what are you trying to understand? What do you want kids to understand? The concept, the generalization, the principle. What do you want them to understand? Why does this content matter? What makes it relevant and it connects it to kids? And then third, who will care about the products that are being created? Because when they're creating these products, I don't want you to have to grade them. I want the experts to have to grade them. I want the experts to have to look at them. So I've got several examples here, and I'm running out of time, but I want to just share a couple of examples so you see how teachers have created these for their classroom. So here's one, and you can kind of read as I talk. So first, the enrichment is about creating a picture book for younger kids. The extension is researching the history of fractions, because remember, we're in the discipline. And then the enhancement is connecting math to another content area. Here's where we're going to make a piece of music out of this using the fractions. And note that the enrichment is a product for little kids. The extension, the product is for a math teacher or a math professor. The enhancement is the product is for a teacher of music. Okay. So you see each one has value outside of the classroom. Let me show you another one. This is ELA. So here we're talking about the study of character, and the unit of study is Midsummer Night's Dream. So the first one, we're looking at lesser characters, because I'm not necessarily going to talk about lesser characters. The outcome to this is for the actor who's going to play the role. The extension, now we're into authorship or playwriting, and playwriting, we're going to look at how Shakespeare used different lesser characters in Romeo and Juliet and Midsummer Night's Dream, how they compared and contrast. And again, the Shakespearean expert is the one who reviews this information. The enhancement is then we're looking at authorship in ELA. We're going to move it over into theater. And so what this one is, the product is that they create a product for the drama class to perform. I've got another one here on planned obsolescence for family and consumer science. I've got many, many examples, because I've worked this through with many, many teachers across the country. And so the idea here is that it gives kids an opportunity to deepen their learning through, yes, the content, but also going deeper. So again, you could use this as every kid needs to do one. What I might say is that the enrichment is for the kid who is going to need the most support. The extension is going to be for the kids who are pretty much on target. The enhancement would be for our most advanced level learners, because they are at the highest level. So my bell is going to go off here in just a couple of seconds. I want you to see, these are my three books. All of them are available through my publisher, which is freespirit.com. If you go to that website and you put in that code, DIFGIF, you can get any of my books for 25% off plus free shipping. So go to freespirit.com, little shameless self-promotion here, get my books. And this particular idea of E3 is in the red book below me, which is called Differentiating for Gifted Learners. So thank you again for being a part of my day. I'm very happy to have been a part of this whole quick 15 minutes, but hopefully you got a couple of ideas from what I just shared here.